All right, class, it's time to begin. Okay. Yes. All right, everybody, settle down, settle down. Wonderful. Good morning, students, and welcome to another day of learning at Carson Elementary. Today is January 25th, 1952. Now, before we say the Pledge of Allegiance to start the day, I want to go over something very important. Yesterday, I showed you a video about ducking and covering. Now, this is something we must practice as a class to help us be prepared for an atomic bomb. Now, we shouldn't be afraid of an atomic bomb because we can be prepared and protect ourselves, just like we protect ourselves from fires by practicing a fire drill. Today, we will be having a duck and cover drill. When you hear the siren, don't be afraid. We are practicing today so we can be prepared if we ever do face an atomic bomb. Remember to do what you were shown in the video. Duck under your desks and cover your face and neck. Now remember, what do? We duck under our desks and we cover our face and neck. Yes. All right. Now that we've covered all of that, please join me for the Pledge of Allegiance. Everybody stand up. Yes, stand up. Good, good. All right. Hand over your heart.
This is Special Collections, radio tours to museums, attractions, and other interesting places that capture the imagination and have unique stories to tell. I'm your host, Jeff Simpson, inviting you to join us as we explore the world through its Special Collections. During the Cold War, the threat of an atomic bomb was very real. Tensions between the United States and the Soviet Union were dangerously high. And so, to be prepared, both sides built up intense military defenses. The United States built 54 Titan II missile sites across the nation. While at the time, these silos were top secret, following being decommissioned, one became open for public tours, and you can actually visit one of those today at the Titan Missile Museum outside Tucson, Arizona. And we are lucky enough today to have Yvonne Morris with us, who is the director of the Titan Missile Museum. Yvonne, thank you for joining us on Special Collections.
Well, thank you. It's my pleasure.
I am so excited to talk to you about this. So this museum literally is a former Titan II missile silo from the Cold War.
Yes, it is. This particular site was part of the 390th Strategic Missile Wing that was based out of Davis-Monson Air Force Base in Tucson, Arizona. And it's one of the 18 Titan II sites that surrounded Tucson from 1963 to 1984. And when the decision was made to decommission the Titan II program, this site was selected for preservation under the Cold War Heritage Program with the U.S. Air Force.
That is so interesting. So I'm curious to know, give us a little bit of context. We know a little bit, you know a lot more than us, so what is it that was going on in the world at the time that prompted the missile site to be built in the first place?
Well, at the end of World War II, the Soviet Union and the United States sort of switched from being friends to being enemies, and we entered a period of American history, or world history, really, that is commonly referred to as the Cold War. And it lasted from the end of World War II until 1991, if you want to mark it with the Berlin Wall coming down in 1989. But it's the longest war in U.S. history. And we call it the Cold War, or historians refer to it as the Cold War, because it was more of a political, socio-economic kind of confrontation between the Soviet Union and the United States. We did not ever actively and openly engage in warfare with each other, but there were a lot of psychological elements that came into play. Each of us supported different sides of various proxy wars that were fought during that time, like the Korean War, the Vietnam War, and things like that. And so part of the Cold War is what's called the arms race that developed between the two countries. And the United States was the first country to develop the atomic bomb. And once we had it, a number of things came into play. The Soviet Union became increasingly paranoid that we wanted to quash communism and spread democracy and capitalism throughout the world. And the United States became increasingly fearful that the Soviet Union wanted to quash democracy and capitalism and spread communism throughout the world. And so we engaged in an arms race where we basically escalated. We continued to develop nuclear weapons. We progressed from atomic bombs to thermonuclear bombs. We increased the size of our nuclear arsenals. And so the Titan II came into being in that kind of context. Once you introduce intercontinental ballistic missiles into the equation, there's almost nowhere in the world that's safe. For my students, when I talk about this in the classroom, I equate this to, you know, we started out World War II. It's like we're 5 years old, and the class bully lives several miles away from us. So when we come home, we feel totally safe. We don't have to worry about the class bully. Then we developed strategic bombers, and that's kind of like we got to middle school and the class bully has a bicycle. And now the fact that he lives a couple of miles down the road, it doesn't protect me like it used to.
Interesting.
And then when both countries developed intercontinental ballistic missiles, and the flight time of these missiles between the two countries became 30 minutes or so.
Wow.
Well, that's like getting into high school and now the bully has a car.
So tensions obviously were super high. Was this something that was present in everyday life for people?
I think it was present in everyday life, especially in the early 50s and 60s when we were conducting drills, duck and cover drills. I don't know how old you are, but...
Oh, no, it's interesting because at the beginning of the program, we actually we talked a little bit about how there were drills in the classroom, and that was the way they taught you to be safe, was to duck and cover.
That's exactly right. Bert the Turtle. So New York City went so far as to issue dog tags to all of its children. New York City actually held mandatory evacuation drills where people would have to go into shelters and then practice. But what we learned over time is civil defense is very expensive. Providing shelters and a way to protect everybody is so expensive, we couldn't sustain that cost. And as crazy as it sounds, it was actually less expensive to develop a nuclear arsenal. It was called the Strategic Triad. And the mission of the Strategic Triad was peace through deterrence. By its very existence, we were hoping to deter a nuclear war from ever happening.
So how powerful was the Titan II? What sort of damage could it do?
The Titan II carried what's called the W-53 warhead. And the W-53 warhead has a yield of 9 megatons. That's the explosive equivalent of 9 million tons of TNT.
Wow.
One Titan II was 600 times more powerful than the atomic bomb that was dropped on Hiroshima.
Mm.
One Titan II was more powerful than all of the bombs used by all of the combatants in World War II, including the two atomic bombs. One Titan II will devastate an area of 900 square miles.
Wow. And this is just one of 54 Titan II missile sites that were on standby during the Cold War. So where were some of the others built?
18 other sites were built around Wichita, Kansas, and a final 18 sites were built around Little Rock, Arkansas. These 54 missiles, we were just a small component of the nuclear arsenal that the United States had at the time, because in addition to the 54 Titan II sites, there were 1,000 Minuteman intercontinental ballistic missile sites. And there were strategic bombers, and there were submarine-launched ballistic missiles. So this land, sea, and air triad, known as the strategic triad, were like three legs of a stool. And each component, we all functioned together. We were designed to prevent World War III from happening, and then, as a last resort, to fight it.
When and why were the missiles shut down?
Well, there were a number of things that played into deactivating the Titan II program. First of all, we were negotiating with Soviet Union, both sides, to reduce our nuclear arsenals. Also, the Titan II program, we utilized liquid propellant. And over time, those propellants, which were extremely toxic, they had started leaching into the walls of the propellant tanks on the missile. And the walls of the propellant tank are actually the skin of the missile. And so they were off-gassing a little bit. And it was becoming increasingly hazardous to work on them. And the supply train for the Titan II was also drying up because the technology was fairly dated. And so the decision was made that we would phase out the Titan II program to make way for more efficient, more accurate, more economical weapon systems.
There aren't any missiles that are still active today, are there?
Oh, yes. We have 400 Minuteman Three, intercontinental ballistic missiles that are on alert mostly in the northern Great Plains states of the United States, some in Colorado, I think Wyoming, but all up in that general area.
So if we want to feel safe, we shouldn't duck and cover, maybe don't even spend the money for the bunker, we'll just head up there, it sounds like.
Yeah, well... You know, these sites were not designed to take a direct hit. Right. The Titan IIs were designed to withstand a nearby nuclear strike.
All this talk of nukes on the show got me thinking about the Indiana Jones series, specifically Indiana Jones and the Kingdom of the Crystal Skull. Now, I'll admit it's definitely the least of the series, but I've never understood why so many people hate this film with a passion. Especially the film's Nuke the Fridge scene.
Five, four, three, two, one, zero.
I mean, it's not like this was Indiana Jones' first brush with death. In fact, if you look back at the other films, there are plenty of times he would have been just as dead as he would have been inside that lead-lined fridge, radiation aside. So, let's revisit them one at a time, shall we? Raiders of the Lost Ark. Indy is dragged under and behind a truck on a rocky dirt road. Not only does he not die, but his clothes come out of the ordeal looking practically good as new. Indy somehow survives hundreds of miles underwater, That submarine was completely submerged, right? Now, I checked, and the current world record holder for holding one's breath underwater is German Tom Sieta. I don't know if I'm saying it right, but it's 22 minutes and 22 seconds. And that was in 2012, not 1936. But who knows? It was a German sub, so maybe they gave him some pointers on how to hold his breath underwater. I don't know. Okay, Temple of Doom. This film wastes no time putting Indy in doomed situations. In fact, he should have died at least three times in the first 20 minutes alone. He's first poisoned at Club Obi-Wan. Then he and Willie jump out the window of said club and fall what looks like seven or eight stories. Luckily, the world's strongest awnings are there to save them.
I don't want to go! Okie-dokie, Dr. Jones, hold on to your potatoes!
And then there's the life raft parachute scene. Now, to me, this is just as unbelievable as nuking the fridge. And at least the fridge was clever. Let me outline how ludicrous this scene is. Indy, Willie, and Short Round are about to crash in their pilotless, parachuteless plane. So, Indy inflates one of the plane's rafts. The three of them jump out of the plane. Land on a mountainside, then slide down said mountain before plummeting into a raging river hundreds of feet below. Then, of course, there's the mine shaft chase, complete with lava and missing track and outrunning thousands of gallons of rushing water. And the whole thing moves pretty fast for mine carts with no power source. A fun fact, by the way, this scene was actually written for Raiders of the Lost Ark, but obviously didn't make the cut. And after four films, it's easy to lose count of the number of times he's cheated death by dodging arrows, spears, and poisonous darts. Not to mention a two-ton boulder, snake bites, killer ants, gunshots, severe blows to the face, ribs, and liver. The franchise as a whole has even survived to see another film, which could be coming out in 2020, 21. They keep changing it. Which, considering the much-derided Kingdom of the Crystal Skull, some might argue that's a fate worse than death. Now, don't get me wrong, I love each and every one of these action sequences, but it's my hope that by remembering just how ridiculous they all are, perhaps you'll cut Kingdom of the Crystal Skull some slack.
That wasn't so bad, was it?
If you're just joining us, we're speaking with Yvonne Morris, who's the director of the Titan Missile Museum. That's interesting what you said about the sites themselves not being able to withstand a blast, because the very next question I was going to ask you about, what were the working conditions like for the people who were there at the missile locations? So it sounds like maybe they weren't as safe as I thought they would be.
So the missile crews themselves, you have four people on a Titan II missile crew, and they're usually dispatched to a particular site for 24 hours at a time, and that's called an alert. So, and once you arrive at the site where you're going to be for the next 24 hours, you're responsible for everything that's going to go on at that site. And so what the crew is doing is they have two responsibilities while they're on alert. They're monitoring the condition of the missile site and the missile to make sure that it's ready to launch at all times, and then they're going to launch the missile if they're ordered to do so. In the event of the mission of peace through deterrence failing, if that mission had failed and the crew were actually called upon to launch their missile, what they would do afterwards is, you know, we would survive as long as we could. We had 30 days of emergency rations that were stored at the site. you know, in case of World War III. We had a diesel generator that would provide some limited electricity for us. We had probably 20 days of breathable air underground before the carbon dioxide levels would reach a really poisonous level. So the crew, when they're on site, most of the procedures that they're doing, they're following a checklist. So the crew would use what's called the launch checklist to launch the missile. After they completed the launch checklist, they'd turn the page in their tech order, and the next checklist is called the post-launch checklist. And basically, you would you would work your way through that checklist to return the missile site as close to status quo as you could. Put out the fire in the launch duct from launching the missile. Make sure the silo closure door closes. Basically, you're hunkering down at that point. And the last step of that checklist is essentially await further orders. And to me, looking back at this, the most telling thing about what the Air Force thought about the survivability of the crew is that's where our training ended. There is no training on, okay, here's how you survive in a radioactive environment. But we didn't even have a Geiger counter or a radiation hazard suit or anything like that.
Oh, wow.
On the site. The crew, our job and our hope is that if World War III breaks out despite all of our efforts, we hope that we're going to live long enough to launch our missile. Because what made strategic deterrence work, and I don't know if you've heard of the concept of mutual assured destruction or MAD, but that was the central tenet. MAD was the central, was the core of strategic deterrence. And what MAD meant is that both the United States and the Soviet Union had enough nuclear weapons to completely destroy the other country and, frankly, most of the world. Both countries had the ability to detect an incoming first strike from the opposing country and to retaliate before that strike would arrive. And so what that meant is that even if the Soviet Union launched first against the United States, we would detect that launch, we would respond, and we would launch our missiles, and so there was no advantage in launching first. You're still going to die in the end. To launch a preemptive strike is basically to commit suicide.
Yeah.
And that is what MAD was all about. And the only way that MAD works is if both countries believe in the power and in the weapon systems of the other countries, which meant that the Titan II sites were right out there in plain view. Yes, we're underground, but the surface features of the missile site are quite visible. And so the presumption is that the Soviet Union knows where every Titan II missile site is located, and that each of those sites were targeted with multiple incoming warheads. So the likelihood that the crew is going to survive beyond 30 minutes into World War III is extremely low.
Yeah. Well, and speaking of that, Yvonne, there were a few times during the Cold War where nuclear war seemed just a hair away. Were there any close calls at that location where maybe the missile was almost launched?
I can't really go into those kinds of things because I don't know that what information is still classified and what isn't.
You could tell me, but you'd have to kill me.
Yeah, but I can talk a little bit in generalities, if that would work for you.
Oh, sure, yeah.
For you. Okay, mm-hmm. So there were a number of times where, over the course of the Cold War, the Soviet Union and the United States were maybe on the brink. One of them, of course, was the Cuban Missile Crisis. And that's the one that pretty much everybody thinks about during the Cold War. That's kind of the benchmark for tensions between the Soviet Union and the United States. But there were a number of other times where internal mistakes on both sides led to actions that could have precipitated unnecessarily World War III. For example, in the early 1990s, when the Soviet Union first brought its satellite detection systems online, they hadn't been operational for very long. They were still sort of in the testing phase, and one of their satellites ended up interpreting a sunset or some reflection of sunlight as an incoming United States missile attack. And so their early warning system was telling them that the United States had launched 5 intercontinental ballistic missiles against the Soviet Union. And the only thing in that instance that allegedly prevented the Soviet Union from launching what they thought would have been a retaliatory strike is that the controller, the head controller on the ground, Stanislav Petrov, he didn't buy it. It didn't feel right to him. He thought to himself that, you know what, the United States isn't going to launch just 5 intercontinental ballistic missiles against us. If this is a first strike, it would be wave after wave after wave of missiles. And our ground-based radar systems aren't picking up anything. And so his recommendation to higher headquarters was that this is a malfunction. And then they waited for 20 minutes to see if he was right. And so that's an instance on the side of the Soviet Union where, you know, we averted World War III. There were a number of instances as well on the United States side where, for example, in the late 70s, at one of the early warning sites, they accidentally loaded a training exercise tape into the system.
Really?
And the controllers thought that the United States was under attack. Now, all the protocols kicked in before the launch orders were sent out, but the early warning stations and the top part of the echelon of the United States, they were gearing up.
Oh, my goodness.
Before it was determined that, wait a second, this is a mistake. There were times like that where, you know, we sort of stepped up to the line in the sand, but fortunately we never crossed it.
Yvonne, I'd love to hear more about the museum itself. How did the silo change from an active missile site to a museum location?
Well, when the Titan II program was selected for deactivation, the 390th Strategic Missile Wing was the site that was first selected to undergo deactivation. So one of the outgoing wing commanders thought that it would probably be an excellent idea if we would preserve a Titan II site for the benefit of the public. And so that's actually how it started. And then we had to negotiate with the former Soviet Union, and we had to convince the Department of Defense that this was a viable thing to do. And part of that was creating a methodology that we could use to assure the Soviet Union that this was not an operational site. So when our visitors come to this museum, they're doing a little time traveling. They're stepping back into 1982. We preserved the site exactly as it looked in 1982, with a couple of exceptions that exist specifically to demonstrate that this is not an operational site. For example, the reentry vehicle of the missile that's on display here has a big square cut out of it so that you can see that it doesn't have a warhead in it. And we also, before we put this missile in the launch duct, we had to cut holes in the propellant tanks, and we had to leave the missile on display next to the launch duct for 30 days with the holes cut in it so that the Soviet Union could conduct overflights if they wanted to confirm that it was not an operational missile. And this particular site was selected because of its proximity to Tucson and because of the community right around the museum. It's called Green Valley, Arizona, and it's a retirement community with an extremely high volunteer ethic. And we knew that we would need volunteers to give the tours to the public and to help the museum function. And so those two things sort of played into the decision. And it just happened also that this particular missile site was in the perfect condition in the deactivation process. They hadn't stripped out too much. You know, the facade was still there. It was very easy to put it back together enough that you are literally just, it looks like the crew just left.
That's awesome. I mean, how many other museums have a decommissioned Titan II missile inside and that people can actually go down into the silo itself? That's just incredible.
Well, there's only one other intercontinental ballistic missile site right now that's open to the public, and that's the Minuteman National Historic Site in South Dakota, outside of the Badlands. I would say of the two sites, both of which are extremely important to our military heritage, it's probably here that the visitor can have the closest encounter with the missile. On our tours, people stand 10 feet away from the missile.
Mm.
And it's a very imposing site.
Yeah.
And we serve a very important purpose, especially today, with the issues that we have with North Korea and Iran becoming potential nuclear powers and what we're trying to do to mitigate that. The threat of nuclear war is sort of back in the public psyche, where it has not been for a long time. And one of the things that these historic sites can do is provide context for people. We can provide a framework for them and a basic knowledge that they can use to conduct their own deeper research, if they like, to make an informed opinion about what the future of nuclear weapons should be in the world.
I love that.
You can read about it. You can read about it in books, and you can watch it on TV, and you can read about it on the Internet. But it won't be, I think, until you're standing face-to-face with it and you're hearing firsthand from people who worked with the system or who have firsthand knowledge of what it's capable of doing, that it can really put an urgency on the things you've been reading about or studying about or thinking about, that it can really come into context for you. And we present a neutral content. We are interpreting a moment in history for the public. And we're not pro-nuclear and we're not anti-nuclear. This is something that existed, and this is why it existed, and this is how it would have been used, and this is what the consequences would have been. But it's not until somebody comes face-to-face with that.
Oh, absolutely.
That things can coalesce for them.
Yeah.
And this generation today, they're the ones, the young folks that are growing up now, they're the ones that are really going to have to confront this and decide what to do.
So, Yvonne, is there a particular story that is a favorite of yours that you like to share with visitors?
I did have the very great pleasure of meeting one of my Soviet counterparts. About 18 months ago, a gentleman from the former Soviet Union and his son toured the museum. And they actually, the family had immigrated from the Soviet Union and had been living in Texas for a long time. And they came to tour this site. And on our tours, we randomly select one person from the tour who's going to initiate the launch simulation that is part of the tour in the Launch Control Center.
Oh, cool.
And by accident or, you know, fate, I don't know, his son was selected to be the crew commander. And so when they told him to take a seat in the chair, he turned to his dad and he said, "Now I do your job." And so that piqued the curiosity of the docent who was giving the tour. And so afterwards, he made it a point to speak to them, and he said, "You know, are you a former missile launch officer?" And the gentleman said, "Yes, I was a Soviet launch officer." And the docent said, "Well, the director of our museum is a former launch officer from this site. Would you like to meet her?" And he said yes, he would. And so they came into the museum, and the tour guide introduced us, and we shook hands, and this was just the nicest, most unassuming-looking man. And he shook my hand, and he looked me in the eye, and he said, "Thank you for not launching." And my response to him was the same. "Thank you for not launching."
Yeah.
And the hair on my arms stood up. This is sort of the epitome of what the Cold War was like. I mean, yes, you had not good people on both sides.
Sure,
and
yeah.
You had good people on both sides. And I think the commonality, regardless of what people think about communism, and regardless of what they think about capitalism and democracy, the fact of the matter is that neither the Soviet Union nor the United States wanted to commit suicide. And there were ordinary people on both sides doing extraordinary jobs, all with good intent to avoid a horrible outcome.
Thank you so much for sharing that story. I think in closing, I would just want to ask you, what is it that you hope, and you've already shared this with us a little bit, but what is it that you hope that your visitors will glean from this experience? What do you want them to take away?
What I want them to take away from the Titan Missile Museum is that this is not a war memorial. It is a monument to peace, but it is a fragile peace, and we must continue to work for peace, and people must think about how we should do that, and they must engage in their communities to work towards peace.
Well, Yvonne Morris, we really appreciate your time here on Special Collections. She is the director of the Titan Missile Museum, and you can actually go and see a decommissioned Titan II missile inside the silo. And I love the alternate name that you gave for this, Yvonne, a monument to peace. Now we kind of want to get a Russian perspective on this, and we are blessed to have Katya Jordan here with us. She is an assistant professor in the Department of German and Russian here at BYU. Katya, welcome to Special Collections.
Thank you. Thank you for having me.
So, I mentioned that we heard a little bit about what life was like during the Cold War in the United States, and, you know, I think at the time all we really knew was stereotypes of Russians and, We saw the Russians as the bad guys. But I'm curious to know, what was life like in the Soviet Union during the Cold War? And what were the tensions like over there in Russia?
Well, you know, it's very hard to make any blanket statements about what life was like during the whole of Cold War, because
sure.
the period covers 45 years.
Right.
And for people on the inside, those 45 years can be actually broken down into several chapters, if you will, because life between 1945, the end of World War II, and 1953, Stalin's death, was quite different from the so-called thaw under Khrushchev between 53 and about 64, which was then followed by the period of economic and political stagnation between 64 and through the 70s and all the way up to the perestroika era when Mikhail Gorbachev initiated some changes in 85, and which ended with the collapse of the Soviet Union in 91. So those were very different periods for the Russians inside of the Soviet
sure,
Union and
yeah.
for other nationalities as well. The post-war years were characterized by excitement and optimism and hope because, Hitler's army was defeated, space exploration was underway, construction projects of all kinds were happening all over the country. But then by the 1980s, there was nothing but disappointment and, quite frankly, cynicism in the way the Russian citizens viewed their own life in the Soviet Union. So the Cold War period was a very diverse period for the Russians.
That's great insight.
Yeah.
So what were their feelings toward the Americans then?
Well, for them, the Americans were I can't really say that they identified Americans as specifically the enemy of the United States.
Sure.
From what I've read, from what I've heard, from what I, gathered from, just by talking to people and partly, living there too, it was more of the Soviet Union versus the rest of the Western, the rest of the world, mostly the West, right? And Americans, because they were so far away geographically, they were not the immediate enemy. They were not viewed as such.
Yeah.
And people were more fascinated with America than were afraid of it. So Western movies were shown in movie theaters and people would go and watch them 2-3 times in a row. And then kids would run around outside and play cowboys and Indians. And adults would, buy the postcards with pictures of American movie stars. They were really fascinated with America.
Yeah.
From what little they could get their hands on.
Right.
So it was not really considered an enemy per se.
So speaking of children, I mentioned that in classrooms during the Cold War in America, you had this idea of, okay, everyone, in the case of a nuclear explosion or a nuclear blast, we need you to duck and cover, get under your desks, and you'll be safe. Was there anything in Russia like that to prepare children in the scenario where there might be a nuclear bomb that went off?
So there were drills,
mm-hmm.
but they were not specifically nuclear bomb drills.
Okay.
Let me put it this way. So, and they were not limited to schools alone. So they were not targeted just at children. They were, everybody participated in them, adults and children. A lot of times they would happen over, weekends because, that's when the children were with their families.
Yeah.
So the families did it together and, they were not focused on nuclear strikes. They were just focused on any kind of bomb attack because, again, World War II ended just recently and geographically, Germany was a lot closer and Germany was perceived more of an enemy than anybody else.
Interesting.
So, it's this memory of airstrikes that happened during World War II that were fresher on people's minds,
sure.
not the possible nuclear attack. So with that in mind, people would go through these drills. And what happened is, so most people in the cities, they would live in multi-story apartment buildings.
Right.
And every building would have a bomb shelter in the basement. And every family or every apartment unit would have its own key to that bomb shelter. So they would hear the sound alarm, in the city, and then they would turn on the radio. They would, hear the announcer saying, this is a test, this is, a drill.
Yeah.
They would, in a very orderly manner, go, get together and go downstairs, go into the basement and sit there for about half an hour listening to the radio and just wait for the announcer to say, okay, this is the end of the drill. You can go back to your lives, citizens. So that's how it was for just regular families. But in schools, they did have drills in schools and in workplaces. And what happened there, they were more focused on administering first aid. So at schools, older children would actually teach younger children how to handle a stretcher, to the extent that, middle schoolers could handle a stretcher.
Yeah.
But, things like how do you treat a person with a broken limb or how do you dress a wound, just little things like that. That again, was focused more on first aid than on a nuclear attack because, a Band-Aid is not going to help you if a nuclear bomb goes off. So, but that was the extent of it. And then it kind of deteriorated over the years because, the 1980s was still, the period of Cold War. But I remember hearing the alarm, the sound alarm, and I'd ask my mom, I was like, what is it? Like, it's just the sound alarm, don't worry about it. So they were testing the system, the physical system, whether it was still working, rather than whether the citizens knew what to do, because by then I had no idea what to do, and I didn't do anything. There was just this weird sound in the air, and then it was over, and that's it.
So it's kind of like how people treat fire alarms today. It's like, there's no fire, I'm fine.
Exactly.
So that sounds better, though, than duck and cover. Getting down in the basement sounds a lot better than getting under your desk.
Yeah. And my mom said, I actually talked to my mom about this. I'm like, Mom, tell me, how was it really? And she said, well, the basement was very clean and very organized. It was actually kind of fun to sit there. And, so it was fun for the kids.
It's probably a good way to cool off, too.
Yeah. No AC back then.
Yeah. So just in closing here, Katya, you mentioned a little bit about Russians and children going to the cinema and seeing a portrayal of Americans at the movies and going out and playing cowboys and Indians. What was Cold War coverage like in the media?
Well, it was interesting. There was not a whole lot of cultural exchange between the two countries, obviously. Mm-hmm. But when it did happen, it was big news. Words like, Cold War and arms race were, repeated multiple times daily.
Yeah.
But things like, let's say, 1959, there was a big exhibition in New York, Soviet exhibition in New York, and then a couple of weeks later, an American exhibition in Moscow, and that was definitely a big deal. Everybody knew about that. Everyone who could go visit the exhibition really did visit the exhibition. And then in 1979, the boxer Muhammad Ali visited the Soviet Union. So that was a big news item as well. So whatever happened, whatever cultural exchanges happened, they were always portrayed from, the positive perspective.
Oh, that's great.
America was never portrayed as the enemy, in the news. Yes, it was. Like I said, it was, it was part of the Western Bloc. It was this opponent, ideological opponent, economic opponent, but never the enemy. And, again, there's this, we need to separate, the official party propaganda and state-owned media versus, ordinary people. The state-owned media can spin the news all at once, and present America and the rest of the Western world as the enemy. But ordinary people were interested in other ordinary people and the lives of other ordinary people. So when that exhibition in 1959 was covered, the technological accomplishments that the Soviets showed in New York were counterbalanced by consumer goods that Americans showed in Moscow.
Yeah.
And that was what Russians saw. And because they were living in the conditions of, strict economic deficit, America became this kind of you know, this promised land, because that's where people lived comfortably, and the fridges and dishwashers and shiny cars. And they certainly looked attractive. So people who got to see, you know, the real material things, they really could, you know, see through the Soviet propaganda.
Sure.
So you're telling us that, you know, America is this, you know, decadent, rotting mess where everyone is miserable and oppressed by capitalism. And here we see all these nice, shiny, comfortable things that we don't have. And we make, you know, bullets and tank instead of pots and pans.
Right.
So, again, for Russians, because there was this deficit of everything, America was this enigma, but it was kind of a beautiful, enticing enigma that they wanted to solve. And of course, they craved that, you know, those news coverages, and they gathered from those news what they really wanted to see in America, and which is what Americans really wanted to show. So the propaganda was not very effective.
Well, you know, I don't think Americans would only see what they want to see, right?
Right.
I think that's pretty universal.
Yeah.
Well, Katya, we're so grateful for your input and your insight on this topic. Her name is Katya Jordan, and she's an assistant professor in the Department of German and Russian here at BYU. Thank you so much for your time.
Thank you for having me.
And that's going to do it for today's episode of Special Collections. I'm your host, Jeff Simpson.
He's so great, you know.
Cole Wissinger produced the program with help from Paige Stevenson. Obviously didn't make the cut. You can hear today's episode and all past episodes on BYUradio.org, the BYU app, or wherever podcasts are found. Oh, and be sure to follow us on Twitter at Special Cole Radio. That's Special C-O-L Radio. I don't know if I'm saying it right. Special Collections is a production of BYU Radio.
Bert the Turtle.